Zondervan presents Crossroads, The Teenage Girl's Guide to Emotional Wounds by Stephanie Smith and Suzy Weibel, read by Ruth Bloomquist. Acknowledgements. To our families, Karen and Matt, Jonathan, Rachel, and Marie, thank you for walking together with us through our collective dysfunction. Once again, God showed us the perfection of His intentional design when He chose us one for another. To my Father, I love you. Stephanie. Introduction. First, we want to say thank you for picking up our book. Both of us have had Write a Book on our to-do lists for years, so we're happy to know that Read a Book was on your to-do list today. There is, of course, a story behind this book and a reason these thoughts were put to paper. For a long time, we have both been involved with a national ministry to teens called Pure Freedom. In fact, Stephanie began her affiliation with Pure Freedom as a 13-year-old retreat attendee, but her first Pure Freedom event as a featured artist took place 7 years later. That's when this book really began. During lunch with ministry founder and author, Dana Gresh, Stephanie shared the story of how she had met her father only twice and had recently penned a song about her journey toward loving and forgiving him. Dana was moved by Stephanie's story and asked, "Do you think you could share that story and song after lunch?" 400 girls got a close-up view of Stephanie's deepest pain as she performed the song First Words for them. Nearly one quarter of the audience, almost 100 girls, admitted that day that they had similar wounds from their fathers. As Steph came down from the stage, she saw her former youth pastor standing there. "Welcome to your ministry, Stephanie Smith," he whispered. In the following 2 years, hundreds of other girls have had the opportunity to let the message of First Words pour hope into their hurting hearts. Two responses have been consistent. The stage fills with young women desperately seeking a way to rise above the pain First Words describes so poignantly. Or girls ask, "Where can I get a copy of that song?" That's where this book comes in. Here's how the book works. While putting together Stephanie's story, we realized her debut album more or less lyrically follows the course of the very story we wanted to tell. Each chapter is therefore titled after a track on the record and begins with a sample of Stephanie's lyrics. From there, each chapter delves into a bit of Stephanie's story. In the process of writing about Stephanie's life, we stumbled upon the truth that forgiveness is not the only choice we have to make in the course of our lives. We make incredibly difficult decisions every day about who we want to be, how we want to live. Following our album theme, each chapter has a section called Choose Your Playlist. In this section, we ask a question of you. The questions are all different, but behind each is the same decision. Are you willing to believe that God is who He says He is, and that His promises of care and love and presence are true? Or are you going to believe you are stuck in a life that will never work out, and that you have no choice but to be unhappy, bitter, and disconnected? That might sound a little harsh, but those really are the choices many of us have to make. Life is hard, so what are you going to do about that? Your song is a section in each chapter that asks you to take an action step. Some of these are simple and quick. Some will need to be completed over time. Some are for the individual. Others invite people close to you to walk alongside you. Some are fun. Some may be painful. In each case, we have prayerfully chosen steps we think will bring you closer to living the life God desires for you. Finally, in So You Want to Be a Rock Star, we visit the stories of ordinary people who have found themselves at all kinds of crossroads. Something in their lives forced them to look long and hard into the grace of God and decide if they believed in it. We don't think we're giving away too much of the plot to tell you this. Each storyteller will offer the same truths. God is who He says He is. He is faithful. He can be trusted. So, are you ready for a hard, honest, healing journey? If so, you aren't alone. Though the pieces of this story unfold through the life of one person, it is not the Stephanie Smith extravaganza. This is your story. It's our story. It's the story of life. Last words. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Matthew 28:18-20, emphasis added. Life is hard. This book could end right now because, frankly, that's one of life's great secrets. And now that you know it, there might not be a whole lot left to say. It is seriously tough out there in the world. I don't want to depress anybody right off the bat, but if you pay any attention at all, you know what I'm talking about. I guess we have to consider the very real possibility that these are simply the last days referred to by the Apostle Paul in one of his letters to his friend Timothy. You can read his words for yourself in 2 Timothy 3:1-5. But I have to warn you, it's not encouraging news. I don't know what your hardship is, but I'm willing to go out on a limb and say you have known trouble in your life. If not, I probably need to take your pulse. Here are some statistics to consider. Nearly 20% of Americans report having experienced some form of sexual abuse in their childhood years. Advocates for Youth. 60% of Americans are overweight, and 34% are considered obese. ANRED. Studies reveal that almost 40% of marriages end in divorce. Americans for Divorce Reform. With numbers like these, chances are very good that, like me, you grew up as a statistic of some sort. My statistic is one of fatherlessness. Did you know that nearly 1/3 of young Americans have moved into adulthood without a father present? Fathersforlife.org. If you are fatherless too, the statistics say something about your likelihoods. They say you are 6.6 times more likely than other kids to become a teenage parent. They say you are also 6.6 times more likely to drop out of school and 15 times more likely to end up in prison while still a teenager. They say you are 5 times more likely to take your own life. Fathersforlife.org. There are other statistics about rape, running away, and behavioral disorders, but none of them are happy. This is not a book intended to depress anyone. No, this is a book about hope. So let's begin with a big statistic rejection party. Now, I'm not stupid enough to think that statistics have no validity. I understand that most of them have been gathered and weighed in some scientific manner that I don't totally understand. I do understand statistics represent a version of reality. But I believe the reality they represent is one-sided. They show us a reality without hope, without possibility, without Christ. The statistics are one voice, but God's voice is something else entirely, and the kind of life you have depends on which of those two voices you listen to. From the beginning, God has been about beating the odds. Are you ready for my awesome literary device? The first words in this chapter are from Matthew 28:20. "And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." These are the last words spoken by Jesus before he ascended into heaven to begin his reign at the right hand of God. See? The first words are the last words. Clever, right? This actually has a greater significance than my own literary cleverness, though. Before Jesus' death on the cross and resurrection from the dead, people believed God's presence dwelled in a part of the tabernacle called the Holy of Holies. They believed only the holiest of people, a high priest, could come into the presence of God. And even the high priest was terrified at the prospect. It was believed that no one could look upon God and live. This belief created some strange problems. For instance, If for any reason the priest were struck dead while in the Holy of Holies, no one else could come in to retrieve his body. So he would enter the room with a rope tied around his ankle. Then, if he committed a deadly faux pas, his buddies could simply pull his body out of there. As Jesus was completing his years of ministry on earth, he was clear that he was God made flesh. People went to ridiculous extremes to be near him, cutting holes in the roofs of homes, climbing trees, diving for the hem of his robe. He was the original rock star. Scene change. It's late afternoon and the sun beats down upon three men cruelly hung on Roman crosses. Blood and sweat mingle on the bodies of the crucified men as their strength wanes with each passing second. Suddenly, the man in the middle, who moments ago seemed lifeless, cries out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?" My God, why have you forsaken me?" A sudden darkness blankets the land as if the sun has been snuffed out by the very hand of God. A quake shakes the foundations of the earth. And then, in the Holy of Holies, the curtain that for hundreds of years was a sign of separation between humans and God is cleanly ripped in two. It falls heavily to the floor and no one dies. The separation is no more. "It is finished," Jesus cried. "Humanity is reconciled to its Creator." This book tells the story of my relationship with my dad, whom I didn't even meet until I was 14 years old. Go figure that one out. I know firsthand how important a dad is to a girl because I grew up with a huge gaping hole in my world, and our relationship needed some serious reconciliation. I sometimes joke around with my friends that I'm the little bird from P.D. Eastman's "Are You My Mother?" I actually just like to make the face of that confused little birdie. But growing up without a dad, I often felt just as discombobulated as that little guy. In the story, the bird has no idea what a mother is. He was separated from her before he could grow any mom associations. He ends up asking random things. A cow, an airplane, and a steam shovel, if they are his mother. In the same way, I really didn't know what a dad was. I had invented a fairy tale guy in my head, but beyond the basics that I wanted to know, did I look like him, laugh like him? I had never grown any dad associations. I had watched my friends with their dads, but none of them could adequately answer the question of what my dad would have meant to me. Could he have convinced me I was beautiful? Would I have been more involved in school if he were around? Would he have made me feel protected? Would I trust men more if he had been there to show me how an honorable man acts? Like that little bird, I had no idea what to look for. I was on my way to fulfilling a number of those other fatherless statistics several times. I'll tell those stories in this book. But I want these first words to reveal who I am today. I don't want to make you wait, and I don't want to leave you guessing. My hope is that people know that what they see is what they get with me. I value realness as much as anybody else in my generation. I am sometimes needy, sometimes profound, sometimes silly, sometimes deep and sensitive, and sometimes in need of a stern reality check from people who love me. I don't want you to think I've arrived yet. In the big picture, it all comes back to those last words. While the world often seems to have little room for anything other than bitterness and division, I see God leading me and you in another direction. To stay bitter is too easy, and there's a part of me that resents too easy. How about you? I'm not one of those people who want a head start in a race. I don't want my opponent to let me win. And I'm in if God says, "I'm going to do this great thing for you, but it's not going to be easy. It might take a while." In all of our trials, in all of our tribulations, in our heartaches and our brokenness, God is there. We have a choice. We can walk with God or we can walk away from Him. We have been given authority. We have been assigned purpose. We were slaves, but now we are free. Too often we bow to statistics, standards, and norms as if they are the only way the pendulum of our lives can swing. I want you to know the truth. Jesus said it. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. John 16:33. At every crossroads you have a choice. Some people choose to take heart and believe the promise that Jesus has won. Others choose a life of futility, always trying to script the end of a story that has.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.